This video is about tumble dryers, and yes, you will get questions on tumble dryers, and everything you need to know for your course. Now, I don't have to go into this too deeply. This is basically an overview for you. You won't get asked questions on the internals of a tumble dryer, but this will just show you how they actually work. The important parts for you to take notice of are the gas inlet, which is always at the back and up on the right hand side as you look at it from the back, the left hand side as you look at it from the front. Then you've got the burner assembly, which is obviously going to heat the air, which will then enter the drum and dry the clothes. And the last thing you really need to take notice of is the exhaust. Now, the way these work is quite unusual because they mix the air that's coming in from the front, from the air intake plinth. They mix that air with the products of combustion, and they put that warm air products of combustion mix into the drum and around the clothes, and then they exhaust it out the back of the drum. This leaves us in a strange position because they're neither one thing or the other when it comes to flue classifications. They operate like open fluid appliances, but they seem to be flueless. So they fall sort of somewhere in the middle. But we'll come on to that in a second. I'll quickly run through the sort of checks that you would be expected to carry out on a tumble dryer. Most of these will be familiar to you because they're quite generic. You would do them on most gas appliances. Regarding the position, it should be on an even floor and stable. It should be sited near an outside wall to allow for the venting to be easy. It should not be fitted in a bedroom or bedsit where the room volume is less than 7 meters cubed per kilowatt. Sounds a bit complicated. I'm going to explain to you how to work all that out in a minute or two on the video. If it's an LPG appliance, it mustn't go into a cellar because, of course, LPG is heavier than air and collects in cellars, builds a way up, and that could cause a dangerous situation. Now, regarding the gas supply, it's usually via a plug-in connector, which is basically the same as the back of your cooker. It's a plug-in with a banjo fitting and a flexed hose. The flexible connector, the banjo fitting, should conform to British standards. And the gas point itself on the wall, rather like you've got rules for the gas point behind a cooker, you've got rules for the gas point behind tumble dryers. It should be 750mm from the floor and 140 to 330mm from anything that it's butting up against on the left-hand side. So, ventilation. As I've already spoken to you about, tumble dryers have exhaust venting kits. They have exhausts on them, and they are classed as flueless appliances, but they should conform to part 2 and communicate directly to outside air. Communicate means that the products of combustion must go straight out to the outside air without any interference. To facilitate this, you have exhaust vents, and all tumble dryers by law now need to be fitted with an exhaust kit. There are two types of exhaust kit. For a tumble dryer that is below 3 kilowatts, you can just use a hose and stick it through an openable window. So these are flexible hoses, I've got no doubt you've seen them. If it's under 3 kilowatts, you can just stick it out of an openable window, and that's perfectly legal. If it's over 3 kilowatts, and they can be as high as 6 kilowatts, some of these, it must be fitted with a permanent vent kit, and the terminal to the outside must be at least 300 millimeters from the ground. So if it's over 3 kilowatts, you've got to make what is in effect a flue out the back using the exhaust kit, and the terminal of that flue going out to fresh air must be at least 300 millimeters from the ground. When you're commissioning a tumble dryer, again, I'll go through these very quickly, but there is one very important one, and I'll point it out when we come to it. Check the installation conforms to regulations. Test the system for tightness and purge the system of air, usual stuff. Check that it's safe to connect to electrical equipment. Check the ventilation. We'll come on to working out the ventilation in a minute, because that causes quite a few problems. Check the drum rotates, the fans run, the burner lights correctly, all the stuff you would actually normally do. You do an inlet pressure check to make sure the gas pressure hasn't dropped 1 millibar between the meter and the tumble dryer. And here's the big one. Check that the fan does not affect other flues. So if you've got an open fluid appliance in the room or in the next room, carry out a spillage test on the other appliance while the tumble dryer is running. Right, so carry out a spillage test on the open fluid appliance that is either in that room or in the next room or even in the next room, because these things suck a lot of air in. And make sure that operating the tumble dryer does not cause the other appliance to spill. That's worth bearing in mind for your course. Check that the outlet's free of obstruction. Check that when the doors are opened, the tumble dryer stops. That's a safety feature. And then you do your controls checks with your timers and your temperature operation, etc., as per manufacturer's instructions. Explain about the filter needing cleaning and leave the MIs with the customer. All standard stuff after that. So, this is the bit that I found most people have most problems with. Because when you're asked to provide ventilation for a tumble dryer, or to calculate the ventilation for a tumble dryer, and you will be in your exams, then it seems quite a lot of people get confused as to what the flueless chart is telling them, because you actually read the flueless chart and it will tell you what to do with tumble dryers. And what the flueless chart says is, where the room volume is less than 3.7 meters cubed per kilowatt, then purpose provided ventilation of 100 centimeters squared will be required. 95 out of 100 people pretty well stop at that point and say, I can't understand that, and then they guess. It's actually quite simple, and I'll show you how to do it. So here's an example question, the sort of thing you're going to get on your Blue Flame or your Logic exam prior to your assessment. So this example question says a tumble dryer of 6 kilowatts is installed in a room measuring 3.5 meters long, 2.5 meters wide, 2.4 meters high, a fairly standard room. And it will say, what is the ventilation requirement? Well, what we have to do first is work out the size of the room. And the answer, or the calculation for your answer, will be you just times all the sizes together, and that will give you a total. So 3.5 times 2.5 times 2.4 equals 21. So that room is 21 meters cubed. So remember, the first thing you do, work out the room size. And we know from the question that the tumble dryer is 6 kilowatts. All you have to do is take the room size number, in this case 21, and divide it by the kilowatts, in this case 6. And what you end up here with is 3.5 meters per kilowatt. And the ventilation requirement kicks in for any room that is smaller than 3.7 meters per kilowatt. So that's smaller. 3.5 is obviously smaller than 3.7. And therefore you will need 100 centimeters squared of ventilation. Let's run through another one. This time the tumble dryer is only 4.5 kilowatts. It's in exactly the same room. What is the ventilation requirement? Well, again, we times all those sizes together and we work out the size of the room, 21 meters cubed. And this time, the tumble dryer is 4.5 kilowatts. So we take the room size, we divide it by the size of the appliance in kilowatts, so 21 divided by 4.5. And that has ended up as 4.6 meters cubed per kilowatt. Well, the law says that anything under 3.7 needs to be ventilated. Well, 4.6 is higher than 3.7. And therefore, there is no requirement for additional ventilation. I hope that helps, and good luck with your exams.